المسدد المصطفى الأمجد المحمود الأحمد أبي القاسم محمد وبآله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين صلوات الله عليهم أجمعين ولعنة الله على أعدائهم ومنكر فضائلهم وغاصب حقوقهم من الأولين والآخرين من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كتابه المجيد وكلامه الكريم وقوله الحق بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ادعوا إلى سبيل ربك بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة آمنا بالله وصدق الله العلي العظيم صلوا على محمد وآل محمد In Surah Nahl, which is the 16th chapter of Quran Majid, verse number 125, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Invite people to the path of your Lord with wisdom and goodly advice. Ud'u ila sabili rabbika bil hikmati wal maw'izatil hasana. A greatest gift that a Muslim can give to his fellow Muslim, to his Muslim brother, is a piece of advice, which can be a seek, which can be a means of guidance for that Muslim. And that is why you will find that when a giver of advice or a recipient of the advice, they are rewarded abundantly. According to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Hadith al-Qudsi, please recite a salawat. According to Hadith al-Qudsi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Hadith al-Qudsi to Hazrat Musa, that, O Musa, the giver of the advice and the recipient of the advice are rewarded abundantly, that their graves will be enlightened in such a manner that they won't be scared in the grave of the loneliness of the grave. Thus you will find that our immas or the prophets, when they would give advice, their advice would be, at times it would be very short, like the advice of the Holy Prophet is example. From the short advices and admonishments of Rasulullah is Udul Marid example, which means go and visit, do ayadat of sick. Yeah, you will find that the giving of advice also from the Holy Prophet of Islam, or the taking of the advice, Rasulullah being the recipient of the advice, you will find in some instances the prophets and immas, they would not only give advice, but they would also take advice. Now this is a lesson for us. You'll find that personality like Rasulullah, he would ask for advice. He would say to Jibreel Amin. Now there is no comparison between Rasulullah and Jibreel Amin. Yet you'll find Rasulullah saying to Jibreel Amin that, O Jibreel, izni, give me a piece of advice. Amirul Mumineen and Kambar. Amirul Mumineen would say to Kambar. Kambar is the slave. Amirul Mumineen is the imam of the time. Again, there's no comparison. You will find Amirul Mumineen says to Kambar, O Kambar izni, give me advice. So when it comes to advice, this is a lesson for us that we can also take advice from our young ones. And that is why you will find people would come to at the presence of Rasulullah and they would say to Rasulullah, Ya Rasulullah, we want advice. And tonight, being the night of the martyrdom of Rasulullah, we want to also learn something from Rasulullah. From the presence of Rasulullah, we want to take some lessons and morals from the presence of Rasulullah. Now you might be surprised. What does it mean when we say from the presence of Rasulullah? Is Rasulullah present? Yes, he is present. Why? Because he is quoted to have said to Jabir ibn Abdullah Ansari that, O Jabir, hayati khairul lakum wa mamati khairul lakum. Which means that if my life is also khair for you, O Jabir, and my death is khair for you. So from this majlis which we are commemorating tonight of Rasulullah, we want to learn something from the presence of Rasulullah. Let us learn something. When we go home, we have taken something from this majlis. It is said that at the presence of Rasulullah, a person comes and he poses a question to Rasulullah. Now, in the riwayah, it is not said that which person was that. It is just said, Ja'a rajulun. A person comes at the presence of Rasulullah and he says that, Ya Rasulullah, give me a piece of advice. So Rasulullah says, I will give you four advices. The first advice which Rasulullah gives to this person is, Rasulullah says, the first advice, he says that, Aklil min ash-shahwa yashalu alaykum al-faqr. This is the first advice, which means that, O person, you have come to take advice from me. This is my advice to you. Rasulullah says that aklil min ash-shahwa yashalu alaykum al-faqr. Control your desires. Poverty will become easy for you and for everybody. Now, in Arabic language, shahwat is not confined to sexual desires. But if you come to Urdu or Farsi, shahwat is confined to sexual desires or lust. But if you come to Arabic language, shahwat is extensive love for something. Yeah? Like you will find. So here Rasulullah says that aklil min ash-shahwa yashulu alaykum al-faqr. Control your desires. Poverty will become easy for the whole nation, for the society, for everybody, for yourself. If you control your desires, shahwat is desires, extensive love for something, like at the presence of Rasulullah, when we say extensive love, sometimes a person has got that extensive love for something. Everybody has got different interest. A person loves mobiles. Any new mobile comes in the market, I need to have that new mobile. A person's interest in his wristwatches, example. Somebody loves cars. I need to have a new car. I remember when I was doing my master's program, and the first day when we started the course, the professor said that everybody should introduce himself. And we introduce ourselves. Then the professor says that when it came his turn to introduce himself, because he said, after introduction, you say something about what you love. So he said that, I love cars, the professor says. I love cars. He introduced himself, and after that he says, I love cars. A new car I should have. Everybody has got different interests. The same way, like in this age, in this day and era, people love cars. In those times, there were people, they would love camels. Because in those times, camels were cars. So a person comes at the presence of Rasulullah, and he says that, Ya Rasulullah, I love camels. Then he poses a question. He says that, will I get camels in Jannah, in paradise, because I've got extensive love for camels? Now Rasulullah looked at him, and then Rasulullah knew, obviously, same applies to us. Yeah. Rasulullah knew that in Jannah you will get everything. Rasulullah replied to him that whatever your hearts yearn for and whatever your eyes wish to look, it will be available to you. It will be made available before you. Why are you worried? The way people sometimes they pose question, that so Jannat ma cigarette hase? Because they've got extensive love for cigarettes. And according to Mullah Versi, he says that, what does he say? I remember one of his joke. He said that a person asked him that, will we have cigarettes in paradise? So Mullah replied that, Barwa waste hu ajau kabse. To light the cigarette, you'll have to go there. In Jannah, you'll have there. And if we hear about Jannah, when we hear, our minds go to Hur and Kusur, Hurul Ain and palaces. So this person also poses a question. Will we be having camels? Rasulullah said, yes. Whatever you wish for, you will get everything there. Whatever your hearts yearn for, it will be made available to you. Whatever your eyes feel like looking, it will be made available for you. In paradise,
So Rasulullah says, the first advice to this person is that you control your desires so that poverty becomes easy for you. When a person controls his desires, poverty becomes easy, definitely. And it is because of us, many a times, we humans, we do not control our desires. It becomes a problem. And that is why financially, people suffer. And you will see poverty in the societies. Because of us, we do not control our desires, our lust, and everything. That is why it is said that when money was invented, Shaitan kissed the money. And he said that through this, I will astray others. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Hadith Qudsi that, Ya Abid al-Dananir wa Darahim, meaning, O slaves of dirham and dinar, O slaves of money, we have given you money because you eat, drink, clothe yourself, and give alms. Interestingly, Amirul Mu'minin, Ali ibn Abi Talib, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, says, he says that having money, the intoxication of money is lifetime, whilst intoxication of alcohol is only for a short period of time, Amirul Mu'minin says. And you will find history is full of incidents. You will find at the time of Rasulullah, there were people, because of their money, they would underestimate the prominent companions of Rasulullah. And Rasulullah knew about that. That is why he gives this advice, that this advice will help you, that you control your desires so that fakr becomes easy for the society. In those times, there were people, they would come to Rasulullah, Ashraf-e Arab, the leaders of Arab, and they would say, Ya Rasulullah, it is very difficult for us to come to you. Why? What is the reason? They would say that we won't be able to come to you because you are surrounded by those companions who stink. Na'udhu billah, ma'adallah. Because they wear woolen clothes like Salman, Abu Zar, Khubayb. We can't come towards you. Now, you know, their words, it spread very fast. It reached to those companions. And they were offended. When the companions heard that, they felt bad. Next day, the companions went at the corner of the masjid. And they started doing ibadat on their own. And they said that, those companions, they said that, we won't go near Prophet. We don't want to become obstacle for them to come towards Prophet. Let them come to the Prophet. On hearing this, when they secluded themselves at the corner of the masjid, a verse of Quran was revealed. Wasbir nafsaka ma'al ladhina yad'una rabbahum. Surah Kahf, chapter 28, verse number 18. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded to the Holy Prophet that, O Muhammad, you stay with those who beseech Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala day and night. And when this verse was revealed, history tells us Rasulullah fell into prostration. And he said that, I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I am grateful towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah showed me my duty, that I have to stay with them. Rasulullah went to them and he told them that, listen, come closer to me. Al-hayati ma'akum wal-mamati ma'akum. If it is to live, I'll live with you. And if it is to die, I'll die with you. Rasulullah says. So this is the first piece of advice of Rasulullah to this person, that control your desires so that faqr, so that poverty becomes easy for you. The second advice Rasulullah gives to this person is that, what does Rasulullah says? Rasulullah says, aqlil min al-dhunub yashulu alaykumul maut. What does it mean? Rasulullah says that aqlil min al-dhunub, control yourself committing sins, control yourself towards sins so that maut becomes easy for you, so that death becomes easy for you. See, when we travel, what do we need? We need to have provision. And what is that provision? Provision is, nowadays, it is in a form of money. In olden times, people would go to ziyarat. I remember, we would give them
Bhatu. Provision or Bhatu in Gujarati. Yeah. Nowadays, those times have gone. Yeah. Nowadays, you need provision. Well, in any case, you need provision when you travel. And that provision is form of money. You need to have extra money. There is transit, there is airport, there is delay in flights, and many things. You need to have extra money. Yeah, this is first thing for your journey. The second thing is that you need to stay away from barriers. And barriers could be many things, like accidents, isn't it? Perhaps there is an accident there, and you'll get closures on motorway. And perhaps you'll have to stay for 3 or 4 hours waiting. If not that many long hours, then at least 2 hours you'll have to wait if there is if the accident took place there. So you'll have to check your route before you travel. So that you need to stay away from accident, closures, sickness, floods, whatever. For that journey, journey to the unseen world, that long journey, that is death. For that also you need these two things. According to Rasulullah. According to Quran, Quran says, وَتَزَوَّدُوا إِنَّ خَيْرَ الزَّادِ التَّقْوَى. The provision for you, according to Quran, for the hereafter is التَّقْوَى. And you know what taqwa means. Taqwa.